Oh man, everyone is waiting for tomorrow because the Bank of Canada is making their last interest rate decision of the year, and this impacts pretty much everyone across Canada, and it could be an indicator of whether or not we're about to hit a serious recession with growing job losses amidst the high cost of living crisis in Canada, or if we're headed on a different trajectory towards a best case scenario. So let's look at this from all angles and talk about how it impacts how much Canadians get paid moving forward, the housing affordability issues we're having, inflation alongside accusations of corporate price gouging, and what this all means in terms of Canadians who are looking for further financial help from the government. Let's jump right in. Make sure to subscribe to the channel if you haven't already done so to make sure you keep getting these Canadian-focused updates. Now, the first thing we're going to look at is a historic indicator of upcoming recession, something called the yield curve inversion. It sounds super complex, but I promise you once you understand this, everything's going to make a lot more sense, and it's super simple. And it all has to do with Government of Canada bonds. If you're not familiar, bonds, when you purchase one, it's kind of like an IOU. You pay a certain amount of money, and at the end of that time period, you get that money back alongside the interest rate that you're charged, or either that you rather that you get paid on this Government of Canada bond. Of course, I'm simplifying for the sake of just this quick explanation. Now, all bonds have different time frames that you have to sort of give your money to get that interest rate, and we refer to that as a maturity. We're going to look at two different types of those, a 10-year bond as well as a 2-year bond, because this is going to explain the yield curve situation we have going on right now. Typically, the longer term maturities, like 10-year maturities, will pay you a higher interest rate on your money because you're taking more long-term risk by locking your money up for a longer period of time. Of course, you can sell bonds, but this is just for the sake of this example. There's more long-term risk over the long term. And on the other side of things, for shorter term bonds, this is a 2-year maturity, you usually have less long-term risk, and as a result, you get a lower interest rate on the money that you're putting in. But what happens if all of a sudden this changes and instead of getting a higher yield on your longer term bonds, you get a lower interest rate, and on the shorter term bonds, you get a higher interest rate? It doesn't really make sense, but that's exactly what's happening right now. That's what's called a yield curve inversion, where people who have longer term bonds are getting paid less interest than people who have shorter term bonds. And that's the situation we're in Canada right now. We're taking a look at this blue line for this example. And you can see for bonds that have a 2-year maturity, folks are getting paid as of today 3.839%. But if we take a look at the 10-year bonds, well, people are getting paid less than that, almost about actually just over a percentage more than that, or less than that, at 2.825%. So 10-year bonds, 2.825, 2-year bonds at 3.83. We've got an inversion here. And on this chart, anytime the white line's below the central red line, that's when an inversion has happened in this way. And we can see that we're at the most dramatic inversion that we've been at since the early 1990s. But what does this all mean and what's actually causing it? How much or how little the yield curve is inverted sort of tracks the way people feel about the Canadian economy at any given time. If they think that things are going to be good for the short term, well, then they'd likely buy more short-term bonds or invest in more risky assets like individual stocks, tech stocks, or crypto. Now, the result of that purchasing of shorter-term bonds would drive up the price of those bonds and as a result drive down the interest rate on those bonds. So usually that short-term debt, the short-term bonds have a lower interest rate. But what we're seeing right now is people buying up this longer term debt saying, hey, I'm not so sure about the short term here, so I'm going to buy longer term bonds. But as a result of that, the price of the bond with more people purchasing it goes up. And as a result, the interest rate goes down. That's kind of the way bonds work. When the price goes up, the interest rate goes down. So people piling into those 10-year bonds means that, well, those interest rates are going to be lower on 10-year bonds, indicating that the market thinks we're going to have a pretty shitty next couple of years. So it's best used as a thermometer. The more it inverts, like we're seeing today, the more people think that there will be short-term economic pain with little investment or business growth. Now, this relates to the Bank of Canada's decision tomorrow, because if they choose to continue increasing interest rates, now most experts think that they're going to increase rates by around a quarter of a percentage or a half percentage tomorrow, well, that could push things farther in this direction, encourage more of an inversion here, and especially if they go too far, this could push rates up too much and push us into a deeper recession. And many people think that this going too far could actually happen by the Bank of Canada because they kind of have a track record of not reacting as quickly as they well should, right? We saw inflation starting to pick up during mid-2021, sort of in this area, but the Bank of Canada, if you remember, was constantly saying, we don't expect this inflation to be long-term, we expect it to be transitory, and that it will sort of come and pass. It's mostly due to sort of a supply chain bottlenecks from the pandemic and things that we think will get sorted over the next little while. Now, as we got into early 2022, they realized, oh, okay, maybe inflation isn't going away, and they started dramatically increasing interest rates, and that's what we're seeing here on this graph. But people have said, hey, if you started increasing interest rates when all of us believed that inflation was going to be around, except for you when you were saying it was transitory, if you had instead started hiking around this area, well, maybe we wouldn't have to go so far right now to tame inflation. Because that's what this is all about, bringing down inflation by raising interest rates, discouraging Canadians and businesses from spending because it costs so much to take on any kind of debt to expand your business or to make your regular consumer purchases. And one area that the Bank of Canada hopes that this will directly impact is grocery stores or the food price inflation we've been seeing. Now, a lot of these grocery store chains have been taking a lot of flack, especially from the NDP, saying that, hey, they're gouging Canadians by raising the cost of the food that they're purchasing. But just yesterday, an executive from Loblaws went in front of a parliamentary committee and said, hey, that's not actually the case.
Like all grocers, Loblaw is essentially a food distributor. We buy goods from suppliers and then sell them to customers. We are dependent on what suppliers charge us when we set our retail prices. Fundamentally, grocery prices are up because the costs of products that grocers buy from suppliers have gone up. In a normal year, many suppliers ask us to pay more for their products. But as the pandemic and inflation set in, supplier cost requests skyrocketed. 2020 was a record high, 2021 was higher, and 2022 hit unprecedented levels.
Whether you believe the profiteering narrative or you believe the grocery stores that they're just innocently passing on these costs that they're getting from their suppliers to consumers, either way, the Bank of Canada is starting to recognize that it has a big impact on this, but not in the way that you might think. Take a look at this.
The danger signs we've seen is that companies have very rapidly passed through higher prices to consumers. And as consumers kind of get used to high inflation, they accept those. So then companies, when they raise prices, they're not worrying about what their competitor is going to do. We need to get back to a situation where companies are more worried that they're going to lose their customers if they raise their prices. But when you've got an economy in excess demand, if you're a company and you can deliver the product, you may be able to, it's easier to pass through those prices, but
Tiff Macklem here, the Bank of Canada's governor, the same guy we're going to hear from tomorrow, well, he's saying, well, because consumers are starting to expect inflation to be high over the long run, it's easier for these businesses to pass on the increased costs that they're experiencing to the consumer because they're not as worried about losing their customers, right? They're saying that in typical times, perhaps even if the suppliers were charging the grocery store chains more, maybe the grocery store chains wouldn't automatically increase their prices as a result. Maybe they cut their margin slightly because they're worried that other grocery store chains are going to get their customers if they raise prices too much. But in an economy like this, where we have persistently high inflation, well, they're just not as afraid to do that. And as they likely raise interest rates tomorrow, it'll be another swing of the hammer against inflation. We're going to have to see how that impacts things. But when it comes to housing, it's no secret that we've seen a dramatic drop in sales. In fact, you've probably seen headlines like this, saying that we've seen a dramatic decline in the amount of homes that are being sold. In fact, half as many as last November were sold this November. That's in terms of volume of sales, at least in Toronto. And in fact, even though house prices are down, affordability for those houses is actually worse than before, even though prices are down, right? You can see here the blue line is the average new home cost, and we can see how that started to come down here. But this yellow bar has been going up while the blue line has been going down. This yellow bar is the housing affordability index, and that sort of takes into consideration people's income and the cost that it takes to sort of pay a mortgage and pay the energy costs and pay property taxes on your home. Now, because we're having higher interest rates now, that has largely been what's driven down this blue line, the cost of housing, but it's also been what's driven up the yellow line here, because with higher interest rates, people have to pay more on their mortgages to cover the interest costs on their mortgages. So prices are down, but houses are even less affordable than they were when prices were high. And as a result, more and more people are getting into areas in terms of the interest rates that they're paying that they're just not comfortable with. For people who have had fixed payment but adjustable rate mortgages, well, they're getting close to that trigger rate where they're only paying interest on their loans. And when that hits, they might need to increase the rate that they're paying, as well as people who are concerned that may have refinanced their properties or gotten a new mortgage entirely during the pandemic at really, really low rates. Well, now that it's coming time for some of them to refinance or to renew their mortgages, they're going to have to pay a far higher rate. And this is leading to the major big banks in Canada increasing the reserve funds they have on hand to make sure that they can cover themselves in the event that people stop paying their mortgages. There's more defaults that they have to cover where they actually see a loss. We can see that in the chart right here. The blue, the pale blue bar is before. This is back last year, quarter four, 2021. And the dark blue bar is quarter four, 2022. You can see far more, like $500 million, over $600 million set aside by these big banks to make sure that they're covered in the event that people stop paying their mortgages due to the interest rates being so darn high. Now, in general, nobody has a crystal ball on where the housing market's going to go, but my take right now is that the Bank of Canada is getting close to the top of where they're going to raise rates to. So if you're someone who might be in the market for a mortgage, you can take that into consideration, though certainly we could see interest rates come down over the next couple of years. So you're going to want to make sure that any mortgage you get, that you're able to actually get a low prepayment penalty. Like if you're to pay off your mortgage and you wanted to get a new one, sometimes you have to pay hefty fees but as a result of your mortgage contract. So just make sure that you're not in mortgages that have those high prepayment penalties. Now, I've already talked on the channel how I think right now and maybe the next few months is probably one of the best times, at least for the next little while, to either get a new job or to negotiate a raise with your employer because of the unique state that our economy is in terms of jobs, employment, and wages. Right now, we have a tight labor market, meaning it's hard for employers to find employees that want to work in their businesses. As a result, we're seeing wages increase, albeit not at the pace of inflation, but we're seeing around 5 to 5.5% increase since last year in terms of wages because employers are paying people more for these jobs because they're having trouble hiring, right? But that likely won't be the case moving forward over the long term because as the Bank of Canada raises interest rates, well, that means that businesses are less likely to spend, consumers are less likely to buy more goods and services, meaning businesses are less likely to hire and expand, meaning that unemployment numbers might go up over the next little while. So if you are in the position where you can negotiate a higher pay for your work or find a new job that is offering higher pay because they're having trouble hiring, well, now might be the last chance to do that before we see rising unemployment numbers as a result of the actions of the Bank of Canada. But a lot of people don't like the idea of this and they don't think it's a good idea to raise interest rates because that might cause unemployment and they don't like the suggestion that a wage price spiral might cause inflation to become entrenched. And in fact, the head of Unifor, the largest private sector union in the country, had some pretty strong words against the Bank of Canada for this very reason.
Rather than developing a tailored response intended to slow profits, stop profit tiering, fix supply chain bottlenecks and help workers keep up, policymakers have taken to blaming workers instead, including the governor of the Bank of Canada, who has basically declared class war on working people in this country.
Interestingly, over the past couple of months, jobs numbers and employment numbers have been stronger than expected in Canada. That might mean that the Bank of Canada thinks that they have more leeway in terms of interest rate increases and that they can go a little bit farther before breaking things because, well, they haven't totally broken the economy yet. We haven't seen mass unemployment. So they might think, hey, we can push this a little bit farther, but they might also recognize that their actions take a while to actually be reflected in the economy. And what the Bank of Canada does also impacts whether or not the government will come out with more spending and more social programs that could help Canadians that are struggling with the rising cost of living. We've heard from the IMF, the International Monetary Fund, that they've told the Canadian government, hey, you got to be careful not to spend too much because the Bank of Canada is trying to fight inflation by raising interest rates. And if you spend more money, well, that could be counteracting and causing more inflation because you're putting more demand into the economy. So until we see the Bank of Canada pivot, maybe pause their rate increases or start to lower the interest rate, we likely won't see the government of Canada introduce any major new spending because they would be blamed for contributing to inflation that the Bank of Canada is fighting against. So obviously we covered a lot, but we did because this decision impacts just so much across the entire economy. We've covered how this affects Canadian jobs and housing and inflation and the accusations of price gouging, as well as the financial aid that could be going to Canadians if we see the Bank of Canada pivot here. But I'm curious what you think about it. Do you think that the Bank of Canada is doing the right thing by likely raising rates slightly tomorrow? Or do you think that they should pause and make sure that nothing breaks over the next number of months and see if inflation comes down on its own? Either way, let me know down in the comments. I read every single one and I try to get back to a bunch of them. And subscribe to the channel if you haven't already done so. I come out with videos like this constantly, so if you want more Canadian updates, it's just a click on the subscribe button and it's free and it helps out the channel dramatically, so I'd appreciate that. But with all that said, thanks so much for watching, everybody. I really hope this video has helped you out at least a little bit, and I'll see you next time.